Thank you. Happy Palm Sunday. That's kind of a weird thing to say back, right? Happy Palm Sunday to you. It's weird, but that's okay. We are happy to have you. So glad to see you. You'll notice that last week, some folks pointed out that we felt a little bit squished. So Jerry came in this week and we made some seating adjustments. So if you're here in the building, we added a couple rows while keeping everybody spaced out. We can fit a few more folks in here comfortably, which is great because next week is Easter. And so if you wanted to invite someone with you, or if you're watching at home and you were kind of thinking about maybe coming back, just know that we've made some accommodations to fit more people safely and comfortably here in the building. We are happy to have you, though. I'm not seeing anybody new. Some people I haven't seen in a little bit, so welcome back. But if you have a prayer request or something you would like us to know, or if your information has changed at all, you can let us know by filling out the welcome card located in the seat back in front of you, or you can fill out one on our app. We also have prayer requests, places where you can fill out prayer requests, both public or private. If you fill out a public request, all other app users get that notification and they can pray for you right away. If it's private, it gets sent to our email address and only I see it. So you can do all those things and so many more through the app, as well as go through most of these announcements I'm going to make today. Coming up, since today is Palm Sunday, it is the official start of the Holy Week, as we celebrate in the Christian tradition. And a part of that, at least in the Princeton area, one of the things that makes us so unique, such a wonderful community, is the Holy Week services. Now, normally those happen at different churches downtown Princeton, and they happen from noon to about 12:30 or so, and they've been doing that for a long time. But last year and this year, we've had to move those online, and they start tomorrow. The first Holy Week service can be found online for all of these. It's whatever church is hosting it. That's where you can find the video. I will try to share them from the Landmark page as well, so you can watch those live or after the fact. And they'll also all end up on the Princeton Minister's YouTube page as well. But the Holy Week services scheduled this year are First Christian Church, and that they will host theirs tomorrow at noon. And on Tuesday, it'll be hosted by Emmanuel Baptist Church. And I pair those together because Norm Arrington will be at both of those. Norm's been around here for a very long time, and he does awesome biblical reenactments. He takes people that were in the scriptures and kind of goes through the scripture with a dramatic presence to kind of really put you in the moment. And you can see that on Monday and Tuesday. There'll be different performances, different characters, but he's doing them both Monday and Tuesday. We here at Landmark are hosting on Wednesday, the 31st. It's a first for us. We don't normally get to host a Holy Week service because we're not in the downtown area. But the online switch to online has allowed us to be a little bit more involved in our community. So you can find our service on our page. And we'll be hosting Donis Williams. He's a new pastor in town, and he is from the Nazarene, Princeton Church of the Nazarene. And so he'll be here, and Bethany and many of us will be here to lead worship as well. Thursday is hosted by the Princeton Christian Advent Church, and they have a new guy as well. His name's Rick Newton. I don't know if you guys have seen anyone lately carrying the cross down 460. His cross has wheels on it. If you've seen him, Rick is kind of new to the area, but he's been doing this since at least the early 80s. All over the world. He's been on all continents except Antarctica, carrying the cross and witnessing to tribes all over the world. And he has an amazing story and wonderful things. And he'll get to share on Thursday. And then on Friday is the crucifixion reenactment. Normally that happens downtown on Mercer Street. But again, it has been filmed and it'll be released on Friday afternoon. So we hope that you can check those out. We hope that you can see those. And we hope more than anything that they bless you and help you get in the right mindset for what Easter is all about. Also, speaking of the mindset of what Easter is all about, the Landmark Easter Egg Hunt returns on Saturday, April 3rd. It starts at 10. It'll be here on the property. We have quite a few eggs. And I've been saying a million. And Lauren's like, stop telling people a million. They think you're serious. I'm not serious. But if you have any eggs or candy and you'd like to donate them to us, you can never have too many eggs for an Easter egg hunt, can you? So we will take any that you have. A million. Yeah. If we got a million, how cool would that be?
Awesome.
That would be awesome. But as many as we get, that's how many we'll have. But the Easter egg hunt starts at 10. We do need a few hands on deck to help hide some eggs. Some people maybe get there around 9, and they can help us hide. I'm looking at you, youth group. I'll get you. Don't worry. You'll have your own little special surprise. Maybe you'll get to hunt for the eggs that the kids can't find. But that is Saturday, April 3rd. Also important to note, Easter Sunday Children's Church will return to the building. It will be on Easter Sunday morning. They'll have their own thing in the building. So at the end of service today, there's a special announcement about that. But so stick around. But for right now, we will have Children's Church returning to the gym on Easter Sunday. I know I have other announcements. Okay. Nursery workers are needed also starting on Easter Sunday, so please see Shannon Allen if you can serve. Many of you were serving before. If you feel comfortable and would like to get back on that rotation, please contact Shannon and we'll get your name on the list. And the last announcement that I have, and you will be able to find this information on the bulletin board as you leave today, Kim Talent is hosting another vendor fair, and so it'll be April 17th. From 9 to 3. And there's not only are you going to have all of these vendors from Color Street and Avon and New Skin and Pink Zebra and so many other things that I'm not going to read to you today. Also, the women's ministry will be hosting a little bake sale and cooking some hot dogs. Am I going to be cooking those? Does anybody know? I haven't been voluntold yet. I normally do because I don't eat them. So I just cook them and everyone else gets to eat them. I don't eat my stuff. So, I need to get that too. But all kinds of stuff. So come to April 17th, come to the vendor fair, grab some stuff, enjoy a hot dog that goes to the women's ministry. And what they're going to do with some of that money is work, believe it or not. They're going to be painting some things, doing some touch-ups around the building. The women's work day is Saturday, April 24th. If you want more information, want to be a part of that, please see Christina Cartwright. And she'll get you all the info you need to know. I appreciate that, Jamie. I didn't have that one written down because I'm not a woman. I don't get to go to the work day. So, all right. So with all of those things out of the way, I need to say it is a good thing to have a lot of announcements because a lot of announcements means that we are alive and we are active and things are happening. Our doors are open again. Things are slowly moving forward, not back to normal, but we are moving forward to what God has for us. Would you stand with us as we pray together and continue to worship? God, thank you so much for the opportunity to do stuff. Some things are fun, and you know, like an Easter egg hunt and things like that. But God, you've given us so many opportunities to impact our community. And maybe something as simple as hosting an Easter egg hunt. God, some family could come and bring their kid just to grab, with the intent to just grab some candy and go home, but they can be met with people who love them. God's people who care for them and see them the way that you do. God, may they encounter the gospel even through something as simple as that. God, thank you for opportunities to serve, not just this church home, not just this building, although that's important, but for opportunities to serve our community. God, give us eyes to see these opportunities as opportunities for the gospel to change lives. As we talked about just a few weeks ago, we can change the world. It just starts with one life at a time. And you've given us opportunities to do that. We ask that we would grab a hold of them. God, may your presence be here this morning. May we feel you. May we experience you. May we understand fully and agree with the words that we will sing today. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Morning, everyone. Welcome. Let's worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords.
Of glory, a king of
Lord Jesus, we love you, we praise you, and we thank you. Lord, that you saw to the other side of all of your pain and suffering and everything that you went through. What kind of love is that? I don't understand it, but Lord, I'm so thankful that you love us that much. Lord Jesus, I ask that you would be with everything that's going to still happen in this service, that you would bless our pastor, that you would bless the special music, and that you would help us to be open to what it is you want to do next in our hearts, in our lives, and in this church. Lord, make us ready to receive your word. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen.
A little background story of this song. I heard this song for the first time at a moment when I was having one of those, God, why me? We've all been there, right? We're probably all there right now for some reason or another. So I want you to go to that place before listening to the words of this song and just think about, why am I going through this moment? And this song really spoke to me that God's preparing me for something.
Jesus, bring new wine.
You guys believe that was her first time singing the solo? Sounds like she's been doing it forever. You even had the talking down and everything. Great job. I know she's been a little bit nervous about that song. We've been practicing it for a few weeks, but that's a true prayer. God, make me your vessel. What is it you want to do? Let me be the person you use. It's a great prayer for all of us today, especially on Palm Sunday. Now, funny thing about Palm Sunday, not really funny, just a thing, I guess. A funny thing is that, like, when I brush my teeth before I shower, I dry off before I get in the shower, right? That's a funny thing. Palm Sunday is such a wonderful thing. Growing up, though, my family didn't really celebrate Palm Sunday. I wasn't really raised, like, in the church. We, like, believed that there was a God, that he existed, but it wasn't a big deal for us. And so, like, I didn't even learn about Palm Sunday until later in life. Even after I started going to church, it just wasn't as big of a deal. Like, I'm pretty sure it was mentioned. I'm sure that there were a handful of, like, Palm Sunday services that I went to. But, like, my 13, 14, 15 teenage mind was focused on other things, like the girl sitting next to me or whoever, than, you know, what was going on. But none of you ever had that problem, right? You guys remember everything I always say, right? I know that. I'm just kidding. But, you know, Palm Sunday just never really stuck out to me until much later in life when I really sat down and really, I heard a few great sermons when I was a little bit older and more mature and decided to actually pay attention to what was being said. And it's such a wonderful day to celebrate. It's such a wonderful thing. And I want to make sure that you guys all have the opportunity that I did to really focus on what exactly is Palm Sunday. Why is it a big deal? Right? Why should we even bother celebrating it? And what does it mean? So what is Palm Sunday and why do we recognize it? That's what we're going to talk about today. Would you pray with me? God, we come today before you on Palm Sunday, and maybe some of us are fully aware of the significance of this day. We know exactly what it symbolizes and what it celebrates, and we know that it starts the Holy Week, and for those of us who are in the know, this is a great day to focus our attentions on Easter. Well, God, for those of us who maybe are a little bit unsure or not entirely sure what this day is, maybe even some watching at home or here in the building didn't even know that it was Palm Sunday, may you speak to us today, wherever we are on that spectrum. May you express to us why this is important. May you express to us how big of a deal it is for us to focus in on Easter Sunday next week. God, we pray that you would speak to our hearts today, speak to our minds, open us to what it is you have to teach us. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, we'll do like the definition kind of Palm Sunday first, and then we're going to go into the scripture. If you want to get there a little bit early and have your Bible or your Bible app ready to be there, we're going to be in Matthew chapter 21. We're going to read verses 1 through 11. But if you want to start at Matthew 20, verse 29, you can, because I'm going to mention that just real quick, and then it'll flow the rest of the way. So, well, you're getting to Matthew 21. Basically, Palm Sunday is the start of the final week of Jesus' ministry before the resurrection. Before Good Friday happens, before the resurrection happens, Jesus shows up in Jerusalem the Sunday before, on what we call Palm Sunday. And it's the kickoff to what we call Holy Week, as I've mentioned earlier. Some people call it Passion Week. And it's called Palm Sunday. That doesn't have anything to do with palm of your hand. But because people put palm leaves, or fronds is what they're called, they took cut them down from the trees in the area and set them on the ground for Jesus to ride on while he was riding on his donkey as he entered the city, which is a sign we'll get to in a minute. But putting those things on the ground is a sign of great respect for Jesus, for who he is. And so that's why they did like a red carpet, except it was green. And in order for us to get a more complete picture of why Palm Sunday should be important to us, we're just going to read through the story. And we'll stop every verse or couple of verses and kind of see what's really going on there. So let's dig in as we try to picture the scene. Try to put yourself in the moment. If you need to close your eyes, you can. Just don't fall asleep. I don't know if anybody here has that problem. If whatever you need to do to picture the scene, and we're going to go through verse by verse. It's very descriptive, so it'll kind of help you pretend that you're there. So in Matthew chapter 21, verses 1 through 11, starting here, it says, as they approached Jerusalem, that's Jesus and his disciples, as they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethpage on the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two disciples. And we're going to stop right there. Where are they coming from? Because that's important. Jerusalem, as many cities were back in the day, had a big wall around it, lots of gates, and each gate represented something. And so knowing which way Jesus came from tells us which gate he entered, and that makes a big deal. So where were they coming from? If you back up to chapter 20, verse 29, it tells us this. As Jesus and his disciples were leaving Jericho, a large crowd followed him. So that's Jericho. They were at Jericho, they did some stuff, and they were leaving there. A large crowd followed him towards Jerusalem. And large crowds followed Jesus everywhere. By this point in his ministry, people knew who Jesus was, so crowds just showed up. And this is the exact same Jericho from the Old Testament with the big walls that fell down, the whole story there. That's the same place. And so moving on to chapter 21, verses 2 through 5. And this is going back. Jesus is expressing instructions. He's getting ready to send a couple disciples ahead of him into the city. And he says this, go to the village ahead of you. And this is a village right outside Jerusalem, like he's not actually going into Jerusalem. But on the way in, stop this little village. And at once you will find a donkey tied there with her colt by her. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone says anything to you, say that the Lord needs them, and he will send them right away. He's like, yo, go steal a donkey. And if anyone tries to stop you, just be like, oh, the Lord needs it, and they'll let you go. It'll be fine. Right? This took place to fulfill what was spoken through the prophet. Say to daughter Zion, see your king comes to you, gentle and riding on a donkey, and on a colt the foal of a donkey. All right, that's a big deal. Now, that prophecy we'll get to in just a second. But why a donkey? And why the colt of a donkey? Why is this important? Why didn't he just get a horse? They had horses. Why didn't he get a chariot or something cool, right? He could have just rode on his disciples' backs if he wanted to. Why the donkey? Well, when we imagine ancient royalty coming to town, we probably picture other animals. Right? When you watch old movies or if you watch like the documentaries or like History Channel or whatever, and they do those reenactments, and when royalty comes to town, they don't do donkeys, do they? What do we picture? And this is interactive. What do we picture? Horses. Yes, horses, right? Or maybe even chariots. They had chariots back then. Like chariots are pretty cool. Why not chariots or horses? Maybe elephants. Anybody watched Aladdin? Right? Now, this is the Middle East. You could ride an elephant into some place and that would fit in, right? This was not a big deal. Like, they could have done that, right? But the donkey holds significance for a few reasons. First, as we just read in verse 5, it fulfills Old Testament prophecy about Jesus, about who he is. That prophecy is found in Zechariah chapter 9, verses 9 through 17. The full context of that prophecy says this, rejoice greatly, daughter Zion, and Zion here is Israel, the nation of Israel. Shout, daughter Jerusalem. See, your king comes to you, righteous and victorious, riding on an elephant. No, right? But like righteous and victorious, you would imagine he'd be riding like a cool thing, the winner's car, right? But no, lowly and riding on a donkey. On a colt, even, the foal of a donkey. He doesn't even get the grown-up donkey. He rides the baby donkey, right? It says righteous and victorious, but lowly. That's important. I will take away the chariots from Ephraim and the war horses from Jerusalem, and the battle bow will be broken. He will proclaim peace to the nations. His rule will extend from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth. That, the river, is the Euphrates River, all right? That's their river. As for you, be because of the blood of my covenant with you, I will free your prisoners from the waterless pit. Return to your fortress, you prisoners of hope. Even now I announce that I will restore twice as much to you, and I will bend Judah as I bend my bow and fill it with Ephraim. I will rouse your sons, Zion, against your sons, Greece, and make you like a warrior's sword. Then the Lord will appear over them. His arrow will flash like lightning. The sovereign Lord will sound the trumpet. He will march in the storms of the south, and the Lord Almighty will shield them. They will destroy and overcome with sling stones. They will drink and roar as with wine. They will be full like a bowl used for sprinkling the corners of the altar. And the Lord their God will save his people on that day, as a shepherd saves his flock. They will sparkle in his land like jewels in a crown. How attractive and beautiful they will be. Grain will make the young men thrive, and the new wine the young women. So this is a prophecy about what's going to happen. Your king is coming, Israel, not in horses because war is over, but because the true king shall arrive on a donkey, the colt of a donkey. And he's going to make everything okay. I know there's lots of imagery and lots of words in there, but that's essentially the purpose. Your king is coming. He will save you. When you see him, the Savior has arrived. And so when the people saw Jesus on the donkey, they would remember this. They would be given his reputation, given the fact that he's done some miracles, some of the things he's said, some of the things he's taught, some of the things that people are whispering about him. When Jesus shows up on the donkey, they're going to remember this. And some people are going to recognize the Savior is here. We're saved. They would recognize that when Jesus shows up, he's calling himself the king from that prophecy. The king of Zion has arrived. The donkey's also significant because, as they mentioned, he will bring peace, right? The donkey is a well-known symbol for humility and peace. So the next time somebody calls you donkey, just know it's a symbol of humility and peace. It's a good thing, right? Riding on the donkey, specifically a nursing mother donkey with her colt instead of a noble steed or like a chariot or a fancy military horse, was Jesus' attempt to really drive home the point that he was an entirely different kind of king than many were expecting or many were used to. Remember, these prophecies had been around for a long time, and even that one in Zechariah says very clearly, look, we're not going to fight anymore. Like, I'm going to come bring peace because I'm king of all kings. There's no point in fighting. I'm the king of all. And I come humbly and lowly on a donkey. But people still assumed that the king would come and overthrow the Roman government. They thought a military commander was coming, even with prophecies like that. And Jesus is on the donkey. He's like, look, man, that's not what this is about. This is a different kind of thing. It's not about earthly kingdoms. Moving on, but jumping back into our story, verse 6 in Matthew, he says, the disciples went and did as Jesus had instructed them. They went ahead and grabbed this dude's donkey. Okay, important to know, the disciples followed directions. I highlighted this specifically. Many times in the scripture, we give the disciples a hard time because Jesus is like, just believe, and they get in the boat, and then they freak out. He's like, guys, come on, man. Or like Peter, they're like, Jesus, if that's really you, let me step out of the boat. And he does, and then he freaks out and almost drowns, right? So here, they did what they were told. They did it right the first time. Go, disciples, right? They managed to follow directions. And maybe it's because Jesus was asking them to steal something, and they thought it was fun. And maybe there was excitement there. But they did exactly what they went. We don't know if the person came out and they actually had to say, look, the Lord needs it. But they did. Moving on to verse 7 and 8. They brought the donkey and the colt and placed their cloaks on them for Jesus to sit on. A very large crowd, the large crowd that had followed him from Jericho, spread their cloaks on the road, while others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. Those are the palm trees there. So why are people putting their clothes on the ground? Why do that, right? It's an act of submission. See, these people that had been following Jesus, first of all, we see the disciples, they take their stuff off and put it on the donkey so Jesus can sit on it. And then all of the other crowd around them starts grabbing their clothes, taking off their outer garments, and just throwing them on the ground so that this donkey and Jesus can just walk on them to go into the city. And if they didn't have clothes, or maybe they already threw their stuff on the ground, they were just going to cut down palm branches wherever they could. They're submitting. These people were so done with the Roman rule. They were so done with waiting for the Savior to come. They were just done. They were signaling their submission to the guy on the donkey. They're like, look, if you're going to ride this thing, we think you might be the king, and we'll take anything at this point. So whether they knew who Jesus was or not, they had some idea that something was happening, and they were just ready for somebody. Somebody. Have you ever been in that place? So hopeless. Just hanging on by a thread that you would take anybody. Anybody that says the right thing, anybody that looks the right way, anybody that has a promise or a sense that maybe they can make things a little bit better. I mean, that's why infomercials still work, right? I need this thing. It's the same idea. These people are just so hopeless and so tired, they're going to take anything that comes their way. And Jesus on a donkey was a symbol of something. And they were ready to submit to anything different than what they were experiencing. And these palm branches. Now, I mean, the clothes is submission, right? You take your clothes off, you put it on the ground. That's very clearly an act of submission. But what about these branches? There's a lot of discussion about the significance of the palm branches. I mean, that's why we call it Palm Sunday. It's for these particular things. We don't call it clothes on the ground Sunday, right? Although that would be funny. We should add that to our calendar. I'll bring that up with the Vatican. But no, what's up with the palm branches? Well, there's a lot of discussion about the significance of them. Some people say that they represented goodness, victory, and well-being. And then maybe, because back then everything represented something. While other scholars say that palm branches were frequently used to honor Olympians or war heroes as they return home, kind of like a red carpet kind of thing. While still other people say that it was a reference to the Jewish festival of Sukkoth, where people would make little booths to remember traveling in the desert before arriving in the Holy Land. Or it could be a combination of all three. Or it could simply be the fact that that's what was available and they wanted to honor Jesus. And so they went and cut some stuff down and put it on the ground. We don't exactly know, but the fact is they did it and it was a big deal. Now, verse 9 tells us this. The crowds that went ahead of him and those that followed shouted this. Just like the Zechariah prophecy said, Jerusalem's going to shout. And they absolutely did. And this is what they said. Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest heaven. We just sang that ourselves, didn't we? Hosanna in the highest. What does that mean? If you've been around church for a few Easters or a few Palm Sundays, you probably know what that means. If not, or maybe it's been a while, at least last year since we talked about it, here's a refresher. Hosanna means save, or in some instances, save now. It's very immediate. Save now. Again, these people were ready for their promised Savior to come. And again, they're thinking that Jesus is going to save them from what? Not their sins. Save them from the Romans. But Jesus is coming to do so much more than that. When we sing Hosanna, it means save us. Save us from what? Save us from ourselves. Save us from our sin. Save us from the evil one. Save us from addiction. Save us from depression. Save us from whatever it is we're going through, the storms in life that we have. Hosanna probably was the same thing the disciples shouted when they thought they were going to die on the boat. Scripture tells us our translations, modern, just say they shouted, save us, don't you care that we're drowning. They probably said, Hosanna, save now. Verses 10 and 11. When Jesus entered Jerusalem, the whole city stirred. That's a big deal. Jerusalem was a big city, especially back then. Like, this was like New York City. This is one of the centers of the world. Jerusalem is a big city. For the entire city to be buzzing and stirred up about something happening is a big deal. Because they didn't have social media. They didn't have news. They didn't send news cameras out to the gate where Jesus was entering, right? Word of mouth had to happen. So this is a big deal. The whole city is asking, who is this? The crowds answer, this is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee. It's only part of who he is. Jesus' entry into, so a lot of scholars think that Jesus' entry into Jerusalem wasn't the only thing happening in the city that day. That's true. It's Jerusalem. It's a major city. They're getting ready for the Passover. A lot of things are happening. From a lot of the estimates that we understand, Jerusalem most of the time had a population of about a million or 1.1 million people. But during the Passover, the Jewish people that were scattered throughout the known world were coming home to Jerusalem for Passover. It could swell to up to 3.7, 3.5 million people. Just added 2.5 million people to the city. So a lot of stuff is going on. And we know that Jesus entered through the East Gate with his followers. But a lot of Bible scholars believe that at the same time, Pilate was entering through the West Gate with all of the extra reinforcements to help keep the peace. Remember, Pilate at this time was just kind of assigned to Jerusalem. He's kind of the new guy there. And it's his job to keep the peace. They know that Jesus was doing some stuff, and it's caused a little bit of a buzz among the Jewish people. And so Caesar's like, yo, you gotta calm down what's going on in Jerusalem. You gotta figure that stuff out. And so Pilate gets sent there to figure this out. And so he enters through the west with his imperial procession of troops to help control the massive influx of people at the exact same time. Now, I imagine that we don't know this for sure, this is just my imagination, but I imagine that he shows up to the city with his horses and his chariots, and he's expecting people to be throwing stuff on the ground for him. Everything's happening on the other side of the city. But Jesus, instead. There was a lot happening that day, but Jesus' entry caused enough of a commotion that people all over the city were asking what was happening over at the East Gate. It's important to look at what they call Jesus here in verse 11. I mentioned this earlier, but they say, it's Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee. That's not wrong, but Jesus is so much more than that, isn't he? And some of them knew it. They knew Jesus was more than that, but that's what so many people said. They call him a prophet, but they totally missed the point of his entry on the donkey. And they totally missed a lot of things he'd said about himself up to that point. So that's kind of what happens. The next passage of Scripture kind of skips over to some other things, the stuff that happens throughout the week, some ministry that he does. But that's Palm Sunday. That's what we know. As we get ready to close this morning, there's the facts. What do we do with them? Like, we know what Palm Sunday is. A bunch of people threw palm branches on the ground. Jesus walked in, created a hubbub. Okay, what's the point? How does this information relate to us here and now? Why should we recognize Palm Sunday as anything other than the Sunday before Easter? Jesus already came, so why not just do Easter and Christmas, right? Well, thing about Palm Sunday, I think we have the opportunity to understand some things that some of these people didn't. See, we know that Jesus didn't come to save them from the Romans. We know that Jesus came to save us from sin. And I believe that Palm Sunday is the perfect time for us to get ourselves better aligned with what Jesus wants before Easter. Some people would say to get right with God. You guys ever heard that before? This is kind of what Palm Sunday is for, in my opinion. I believe that Jesus is calling us to lay our cloaks down in surrender and recognize that he's going to do something. Just like we sang with that song earlier, right? Make me your vessel, as we're about to sing, available, right? That's the whole point. What do you want from us, Jesus? What should we do? We surrender to you. We ask that you save us from ourselves. But saving us, he doesn't just like free us from our sins, set us up, and then let us go on our own. He saves us for a purpose. What is it that God's calling us to do? Maybe God's calling us to surrender our lives to him. Maybe you're watching at home. Maybe you're here in this building. I don't know where everybody's spiritual life is. Maybe you've kind of been playing church or been exploring this idea of becoming a Christian or whatever, but today's a good day to commit to that. So maybe you need to surrender your life to God. Say, look, I'm all in. Maybe he's calling you to surrender and lay down your pride or your fear. Maybe it's just about life in general. Maybe it's your pride and it's your fear about sharing the gospel with people in your life. Maybe you're nervous about being awkward or being weird or changing the dynamic with somebody. Well, that's a fear that you need to let go of today. Maybe you need to share the gospel with someone, or at the very least, share how God has changed your life so they can experience it too. So many people are out there saying, Hosanna, save us. But they're yelling it at the wrong stuff. Save me diet pills. Save me this cigarette. Save me this bottle of alcohol. Save me this physical relationship. Save me this boyfriend. Save me this girlfriend. Save me whatever. My job, my money. They're saying Hosanna. They're shouting it at everything. And if we can play a part in introducing them to the only thing that can save. Maybe it's time for us, somebody here, to just lay down and surrender your hopes, your dreams, and the plans for your life. Maybe you came to Jesus maybe a long time ago, but you've been kind of trying to do things your way. And God has a different plan for you. Maybe he's calling you to do something different. Maybe it's a career change. Maybe it's a relationship change. Maybe it's an education change. I don't know what it is. But maybe your plans don't line up with God's, and it's time for you to surrender your plans and let it go. God's are better than ours anyway. I don't really know what God's calling you to lay down this morning, but I know he's bringing something to your mind right now. He's asking you to surrender something. As we close out our time together, the challenge for us on Palm Sunday is to lay down all the excuses. Let him guide us, speak to us, and be our king today. Would you stand as we sing? God's calling us to surrender. What do we need to do to get right with Jesus today? So we can give our full attention to his story through the Holy Week and through Easter next week. That's a question you're going to ask yourself. And if you come up with something and you need some help or some guidance, feel free to get in touch with me. And I would love to talk you through that and see what it is that God's calling you to do. Help you find some clarity in that. Before we head out, a couple quick announcements. The first is you can find all the vendor fair information on this paper on the bulletin board on your way out. I'll have it there. Also, it is baby bottle season for the Able Pregnancy Resource Center. We have a few up here. Most of them have been moved to grab them on your way out the doors to make it a little easier to grab them on your way out. And finally, an announcement that is, you can have a seat. It's a little bit of a difficult announcement, but we are returning our children to the in-person services on Easter Sunday. And when we first talked with Craig and Jennifer, Jennifer said, yes, I can do it, I'm in. But she called us back last week and just said, I don't feel like I can return. I don't feel like that I am the person to take the children's ministry, to continue on in the children's ministry anymore. So they have effectively resigned. And they just, they love the kids, and they loved serving here, and I know our children's ministry loved them as well. But they just said, Jen was talking to me on the phone and said, look, I want what's best for the kids, and if that's not me, then that's not me. And so we will be, I asked them if they wanted to come and be recognized on the 11th, the Sunday after Easter. And they said, no, they don't feel comfortable with Lucy's health issues. They don't feel comfortable coming in around crowds or anything. So we're going to collect some things. If there's a card or any kind of a gift or anything you want to give them to express thanks for all their years of service here, get them to the church before April 11th. I will grab them, collect them, and send them out on the 12th. In the meantime, we are still moving ahead with our plans. The Elder Board has asked Lauren to fill in as the interim until the Elder Board gets together next month and puts together a better plan of how to fill that spot permanently. So with that being said, we're going to pray for them, first of all, as we dismiss today, as God would direct them. And they did not say whether or not they were leaving Landmark, but they aren't going anywhere in public right now anyway. So what that future is up to them. We're not sure. We hope to see them again when they feel comfortable, for sure. But would you pray with us for them this morning? God, we thank you for Jennifer and Craig and for the love they had for the children of Landmark. We thank you for the many years of service they have given us. We thank you for their hearts and their desires. We thank you that, God, that you helped them recognize that maybe this was no longer the right fit. That's a big deal when people recognize when you're moving us into different areas. And so we ask that you would bless them in whatever it is, whatever steps they take, whatever it is that you're calling them to. We pray that you would guide them there, that they would be blessed beyond imagination for honoring you and for taking that step. God, we pray that they would understand and know how much they are loved by this church and that they will be missed in their roles of service. We want them also to know that Landmark is always available to be their home. God, we do pray a special blessing on their lives today and for Lucy. We ask that you would protect them, that you would keep them safe. We ask for each of us that we would have the ability to recognize, God, when you're calling us to something or when you're calling us away from something, that we could be in your will all the time. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You are dismissed.